Welcome to part 4 of this Unity tutorial series, where we're creating a survival shooter game using Unity's new implementation of the Entity Component System Pattern, or Unity ECS for short. In part 3, we learned how to consume real input and transform it into data values that could be used in the context of Unity ECS, more specifically by our player movement system. In this video, we'll finish player movement by adding rotation that's based off of the current mouse position. So, without further ado, let's get right into it. The player's movement and rotation should function independently of one another. Movement is based on horizontal and vertical input from the keyboard. Rotation, on the other hand, should be based on the current mouse position. Basically, we want the player character to always be looking at the mouse. To accomplish this, we'll need a way to translate the position of the mouse on the screen to a point in the world on the same horizontal plane as the player character. To this end, we'll add a plane to the scene that'll serve as both the ground on which the player will travel and a point of reference that we'll use to transform our mouse positions into world positions. During each frame, we'll cast a ray from the mouse down into the scene. Then, we'll grab the coordinates of the point at which the ray collides with the ground game object. Lastly, we'll write some logic that'll use these coordinates to rotate the player character accordingly. Before we can write any code, we'll need to prepare the scene. First, you may have noticed that I've added a rectangle to the capsule that represents the player character. This is just so we can visualize the rotation later on. It isn't important to the functionality. What is important is the plane that'll represent the ground and act as our point of reference. Let's add that now. And let's also add it to the floor layer. We'll need this later on, when we use Unity's Physics class to perform the raycast. Next, we'll need to create a component to hold the data that'll represent our player character's rotation. I'll call it Rotation Component. This component will contain a single quaternion field that I'll call value. This is known as a value component because its name reflects the value that it holds. The rotation component will be utilized by two systems. The first system will set the value of the rotation component using mouse-based rotation logic. And the second system will simply apply the value of the rotation component to the player character's rigid body. Let's start with the first system. I'll call it Player Rotation System. Player Rotation System will derive from the Component System class and override the onUpdate method. We'll add a struct to represent the type of entities we want this system to operate on. I'll call it Filter and give it a field for Transform and Rotation Component. We'll use this struct to gain access to all of the entities that contain at least a transform and a rotation component. In the onUpdate method, we'll perform our raycast and rotation calculation. This is pretty common logic in Unity. First, we cast a ray into the scene using the current mouse position, which is relative to the screen. If the ray detects a collision with a game object in the floor layer, that'll be our ground game object, then we kick off the rotation calculation, which loops through each entity that satisfies our filter. The calculation uses the difference between the collision point and each entity's position to produce a quaternion that represents a new forward angle for that entity. It then stores that quaternion inside of the entity's rotation component. Now we can create a system that'll take the rotation component value and apply it to the rigid bodies of the entities that they're attached to. I'll call it Rotation System. Again, this system will derive from the component system class and override the onUpdate method. And just like before, it'll have a struct that represents the type of entities that the system will operate on. Let's have the rotation system use injection so we can rehash what we covered in part 3. We'll give the struct two component arrays, one for rotation components and the other for rigid bodies. We'll also give it an int called length that represents the number of entities that Unity finds in the scene with these two components. Now, I'll add a data type field to the system class with the inject attribute. The inject attribute instructs Unity to provide this field with an instance of the data struct. Unity will use reflection to examine the struct's fields and populate the instance with the appropriate values in the appropriate order. This concept is known as convention over configuration. Lastly, we can use the data field to iterate over all of the entities that meet the rotation system's requirements and apply the value of each one's rotation component to its rigid body. Back in the editor, we can press play and scan the entity debugger to locate our new systems. And now, test player rotation, both on its own and now alongside player movement. Beautiful. Just a heads up, the Unity project used in this video is available to my Tier 2 patrons. If you'd like to download the project files and support my content, please consider becoming a patron today. I include bonus content in each package. Today's bonus content includes integration tests that assert the correctness of the logic used in our systems. So that was two versions of the hybrid approach to Unity ECS. In the next video, we'll take our first look at the pure approach to Unity ECS by implementing player shooting. If you found this Unity tutorial helpful, please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And for more Unity tutorials just like this one, don't forget to subscribe with notifications on. I'll catch you in the next video. Thank you to all my patrons, and a special shout out to Glasswell Entertainment, Richard Stance, and Yakov.